Okay. So, Lana, over to you. If you can just present yourself briefly. We have met and I know.
Okay, so I'm Lana. I'm working at ITER organization, which is a fusion facility in the south of France. So I've been there more than 10 years and I'm working on data mining and data archiving. So I had to give this talk on very short notice. So I'm sorry if, so I try to make, so the objective of this talk is to present actually some preliminary results of single writer, multiple reader on spectrum scale. We are a heavy user of single writer, multiple reader. I will explain why in the next slide. So, and part of the, what I hope that we could get some, because I see that in the previous talk, there are many experiments which use GPFS. So maybe we can get also some ideas on how to tune our system and also, yeah, some ideas. I have also some questions for discussion also at the end of my talk. So yeah, the agenda is I'm going to present our requirement, the test we would like to carry to validate the file system and our software also, the preliminary result. So it's really preliminary. So we cannot conclude with this slide actually. And also the next step. So some background information. So I'm working at the control division. So basically we have many plant systems to integrate, roughly 207. And they use various technologies. So there are some so slow system, PLCs. Some of them are going to use COTS, mainly the diagnostic. So I hear some talk about Iger. So this is one of the things we are going to use, but we have also some detectors that are going to use the old version, which is Pilatus. We try to say no to them, but they can't. And we have also fast acquisition. So we have different networks depending on the data and depending on the usage. So we have PON, which is mainly conventional control. We have TCN for our timing, DAN for the fast archiving, and SDN, which talk with PC, HPC, plasma control. We have conventional part here, interlock part, and safety part. One of the requirements is we should be able to access the data coming from the conventional PON, from the plasma control, from the interlock and safety using the same API, because there is a need, for instance, if there is a plasma discharge, they want to analyze some interlock event or safety event. So that's basically the idea. Then regarding the requirement, we have hundreds of plant systems and they are not actually, it's in kind. So they are developed externally. So you can imagine they are going to have different code quality, different type of code, I would say. And they are going to produce this data in parallel. And the main challenge for us would be the magnetic diagnostic, where from one single system, they are going to produce roughly 27 gigabytes per second. And but in this system, it's rather good because one data sources will produce 500 megabytes per second. So it means that we can scale by playing with the number of machines. However, their data is already encoded. It's like a compression, but it's not really a compression. They have to do that because if they don't encode, it will double or triple, we made the math, the data rate. And they have to store some information. So it is stored unusually as unsigned 64. And we use the metadata H5 attribute to store actually the header so that we can decode it later on. We need to be able to sustain the data rate for 1 hour. And we have another requirement is to be able from the source to be able to stream the data twice, one to our internal network and another one on the external network to allow other people, a wider audience to access the data. We have another system which is a RAD X-ray monitor where actually they get a maximum throughput for one channel at 1 giga sample per second, and it's 2 bytes per sample. And from this board, they are going to have 2 channels. So it means that we need to be able to stream from one machine, from one fast controller, 2 gigabytes per second times 2 channels times 2 parallel stream, which is rather, it put a very big constraint on the sources. And we shall be able to stream this without any data loss for 60 seconds. Unfortunately, we asked them if compression would be an option, and it has to be ruled out. They are not confident enough. They don't know their data, so they have no idea if it compresses well. Then the other requirement is we need to be able to support for concurrent read and write. So while they are doing the magnetic, people are doing their test for 1 hour, they shouldn't wait for 1 hour before being able to access this data. So they want to be able to start the plot, the processing very shortly after, like 5 seconds, 10 seconds, the data is produced, they need to be able to access the data. For the first plasma, what we expect is 100 of writer nodes in parallel. And we have a requirement to have the data storage needs to be on premises. So regarding the reading requirement, we expect to have thousands of concurrent users during plasma operation. And it turns out to be rather difficult to collect read requirements from users. When we ask them, okay, what are your read requirements? It's not really clear to them. Mainly, they really need to start to play with the data to really to see. So I think it will become clearer in the coming years. But we have some diagnostics, they already have a strong requirement. So for instance, because we have two data patterns, one which is a data visualization tool and the other one is data processing. So in Fusion, they are using a lot of data visualization tools. This is very important for them. So for example, magnetic diagnostic, what they want to be able to see is for their signal at 2 mega, they want to be able to plot 100 signals within 10 seconds, and they want to have the envelope on min and max so that they don't miss the peak. For the heating system, it's a slower system. It's 2 mega, but they want to be able to mix PON, SDN, and DAN. 100 signal, but within 5 seconds, envelope on for a pulse. So it's less than this one because this one is 100 at 2 mega, and here it's a mixture of 2 mega, 10K, and slow signal, 5 seconds, for instance. We have to do that while concurrent read and write for all these cases. And we have also various data type plot types. So we are working with contour, surface, images, spectrum, X-ray plot. Regarding the data processing, the first requirement we have is, so in plasma operation, so usually what you do is you start a pulse, then you do your analysis very quickly, you analyze the result, and then you say, okay, shall I change my configuration, yes or no, and then I can start the next pulse. So basically, we agree that the full chain has to be finished within 5 minutes, and we have 30 minutes between pulses. For first plasma, the maximum forecasted pulse length is 5 seconds. So this is okay, but after the different stages, this will not be okay. Because if you have a pulse of 1 hour, we need to change the strategy then. And we have another system, which is what we call the tokamak monitoring system, which is like a quasi-real-time analysis, but it's not really quasi, fine, it's quasi-real-time in the sense that it's second, and they need to be able to ingest 5,000 signal kilohertz. So it's like a subscription. It has to be on DAN because it's not, it cannot be on SDN because it doesn't talk with PCS, and 4PON is too high. So it has to come from the archive, and we need to be able to provide like a subscription of this 5,000, but this 5,000 signal can be on structure, and we have to do that in less than 1 second, and they're going to ask this in a loop, infinite loop so they're going to ask, okay, give me the last 5 seconds you have in the data in a loop for this entire system. It's mainly to compute the stress, the fatigue of the component. And this is a continuous process. Another requirement we have is we should expose our data access work in an API. So we don't expose the backend. So the user should not be aware if it's a HDF file, if it's a database. So we don't expose the HDF file directly. The only use case where we would expose HDL5 is only for public. But then we will need to transform our file to be human readable, because if you look at our, especially the DAN is not human readable. The SDN is more or less human readable. When I say human readable, is if you take the H5 view, it will not help you. And what is important is for the moment, the requirement about compression, which is linked with image and video, we don't have any clear requirement there. So we don't know how the diagnostic team, what type of compression they're going to use, how they're going to send us the data. This is not clear. So this is something we plan to work in the next year. But I see already in the previous talk that there are already good use cases, so we can take some inspiration there. And one of the things is, of course, we need to see if the filter, H5 filter, is okay for decompressing. If we have a user-defined compression. The main worry here is the interface may be a little bit too rigid, in the sense that some people, they are going to store attributes in the file, and we need to be able to use this attribute in the file to decode the data. But let's see if it's possible. Regarding the technology, DAN is based on C, so we are using the C-level API of HDL5 to do our thing, and we are using TCP for the moment. For SDN PON, what we did is we have more or less the same front end, and you have an option to switch between SDN and PON, which will actually use either the UDP, the transport layer from SDN, or from PON. And from PON, we have two versions, one based on channel access and another one on PVA. And we use HDL5.5 for SDN and PVA. We have also something for CA, and but currently what we are using at ITER, RDB, the first part is on RDB, and the long term is on HDL5. And for this one, alors, in case of DAN, it's mostly atomic data type, so unsigned 16 or float. We support very simple structure, so one level. But in case of SDN and PON, they are much more complex structures. They are heavily nested, and it can go up to 5,000 feet. So we are hitting some limitations here on the H5 compound, because I think there are limitations of 124 fields. So we had to break the structure into multiple compounds to be able to work around it. But this could be, we wanted actually to talk about it, but we didn't have time to prepare it properly. So as I said, we are using a single writer, multiple reader, 112. So what we have is, we have our data acquisition, which is archiver, and on the machine where the archiving, so writing to HDF5 is located, we have what we call indexer, which is a critical component in our architecture, because it detects that a file has been created. Then it declares that in our database with the location and the structure, so that the reader can know that there is a new file and what are the contents. We can use single writer, multiple reader, because in case of DAN, the schema is fixed. It's two data sets, block header and payload. It doesn't depend. And for PON and SDN, what we do is we have a configuration file to create the structure. And if we don't have a configuration file, we can.
Il franglais.
Yeah. So we use PostgreSQL to the PostgreSQL database contain key metadata to speed up the search and to be able to make a search across the HDF5 file. And this is automatically extracted by the UDI indexer. Typically, the structure, the full structure, we store that in PostgreSQL so that we can present that quickly to the user. We use a client-server model for the data access, and we heavily use H5 attributes to store the metadata. For them, we have two data sets, payload and block header, and it's fully optimized for writing. For PON and SDN, we have much more data set. In case of PON, we can go to 100K. And for this, we had to disable the chunk cache because otherwise we were hitting a memory limit. And we will use a component out to structure the, to store the structure. So regarding the validation of the data handling system, what we did is that actually there are two parts. There is a data validation, meaning that we need to verify that the data is written properly, verify that the data is read properly also. So for this, what we did is we did audit, we audit our software to another tokamak. We use the one located in US, D3D. And what they had is they were using their acquisition system and our in parallel, and we were comparing the data. And with this, we could validate that the data was similar. And we also had the possibility to transform their data into our HDF5, same format, and we could compare that the data was similar via visualization tool and processing. We also need to validate the performance and the scalability of our solution. And for that, we produce a test plan based on the requirement I mentioned before. And for that, of course, we need hardware because to simulate performance, we need good hardware. So for this test, we wanted to evaluate spectrum scale. We use ESS 3000 as a file system. And we, what we try to do is simulation of write, read, and read, write, concurrent. And also we added delete because in our case, we have a temporary storage. So what will happen is like a circular buffer. We need to be able to delete some of the data.
Lana, so, time is up. Lana, your time. So if you could just wrap up.
Ah, I don't know. Ah, okay, sorry. Oh, I didn't. It's going very fast.
Could, 3 minutes, yeah.
Okay, so writing, we were using 4 fast controllers. We were streaming 6 sources each at 500 megabytes per second, 30 channel. And we also try to write 25 topics at 10 kilo. And regarding the reading, what we were trying to do is to simulate up to 128 clients, which were issuing 100 requests. And the requests were varying, could be same one for the all the clients, different one. And the number of points to be retrieved could be from 0 to 16K, and we were changing the file size from a few hundred megabytes to 50 gigabytes, so that to have different combinations. So this is our setup. So this is a 4 publisher connected to Cisco switches. This is the archiver. And this is our spectrum scale file system here and our client. So to be fast, the key point, Mellanox interface, it was, we were having at each publisher and archiver 25 gigabits x2 network interface. They were having 192 gigabytes of RAM. The CPU, you have the model here. And what else? Yeah, I think that's it. This is the main. And we are using InfiniBand for the network between the archiver and the spectrum and UDA also. So regarding the first, what we started to do is spectrum scale profile, very so from the document, from native, so from the tool from Spectrum. So what you can see is there were no bottleneck from spectrum scale on the paper. So it seems okay if you with a sequential random write, it was okay. And it scaled rather well when you had more threads. So no, and from the read, it was okay. So on the paper, the file system seems okay. Now what we did is we move one level up. We say, okay, let's try to use another native tool, H5 perf serial. So here, this is from, and what we try to do is we write 100 gigabytes and we use exactly the same chunk as the block size. So in our case, our system was configured with 4 megabyte block size. So we use chunk size on HDF5 to match the 4 mega. So basically, this is the POSIX result and this is the HDF5. So here in that case, the overhead is not too bad, actually. We don't lose a lot of performance. However, what we observe is this result, it really depends on the time when we run and also on the machine. So which we didn't like. It's not really deterministic. So what we did after is we move another level up is we use our tool, our profiling. And what we observe is we didn't have time to investigate after run, but we observe that the latency and the rate is not always the same. After the 30 seconds, and this is always after 30 seconds, we have an issue on the performance, and then it go back well. So it means that's why our average is not really good. So the transfer rate was 574. So this is something we need to see why after 30 seconds there is something. So after, what we try to do is to be able to write 2 gigabytes. So the result is if we have one channel, we could sustain 80 seconds, and 2 channels, we start to lose after 35 seconds. We use a process counter monitor module, and it turned out that there was an issue with the NIC because they are connected to the same socket. And of course, it's a bottleneck. And the next step we want to do is to use Affinity to isolate the thread on the archiving part. The DAN sources, we also try to do to stream 4 DAN sources at 500 megabytes for 1 hour. This is okay. So it means that scale should be okay. But the big issue we had was with reading. The first tests are not really convincing because one reader, when it tune one reader, 100 requests, it takes 15 seconds. So we got more or less stable performance until 8 clients, but then we have a linear performance drop. And 120 takes 180 seconds. So for the first, yes, it's my last slide. For this test, the I/O was not the bottleneck. It was other things, the CPU usage, and we had a lot of small requests. So to conclude, so the test is still going on. We are doing a lot of investigation profile. We also internally going to develop some profile for reading for our code to see what's going on there. Another thing we are going to see is to evaluate the CPU architecture. So we need to compile the data access on another architecture, which is PPC. For this work, we are getting the help from IBM expert, and I would like to thank here Louis. We are getting the help from our IT department for the hardware and all that, which is very good. One of the things we wanted to see is if a vol virtual object layer for spectrum scale and swimmer, but tune for spectrum scale could be a good idea. So, and I want really to highlight that the image video data type was out of scope because we did not have clear requirements. And we still have the performance issue with the hyperslab for 1D detector, 1D vector. That's it.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay. I think we have to move on, but it looks, I mean, I don't know, from my just a quick overlook of what you presented, I think what was presented yesterday could be very interesting, H5 Cora or something, yeah. They're doing solving a similar problem, I think. But okay, thank you very much. And let's, I want to get the two behind in time.